And just like that, we're off. What's going on, Capital Extra? Yo. Robert Bruce in the building.
Man, like Robert Bruce, you know? the famous Robert Bruce.
The famous. You saw the paparazzi outside for me this morning.
He went for me, boy. I had my hat on, my puffer jacket. I was like, who's this black guy? You know, paparazzi, they don't care about me, you know?
For real?
This, well, I don't have value like that, innit?
No, I'm not lie.
Like, no, but I'm like, oh, man, we got this picture of Mo, man.
Yeah.
Just get a picture of me anywhere. Do you know what I mean? Like, I have no value. You know what's mad, though, yeah? When it was Halloween, I went to Jonathan Ross's Halloween party, innit?
Okay.
So when you go outside, there's like people who live around the area that just go to see who's turning up, innit?
Yeah.
So I went the year before, innit? So like last year. And I had like, I think I went as Eddie Murphy from Coming to America, when mm-hmm. the McDowell's thing. So I was wearing that and I come out the taxi and they're like, who's that? Who's that? And I was like, I was like, nah, man. When I come back here next year, I'm getting all the snaps, innit? So this year I had a mask, innit?
Yeah.
And then I had a mask. And then I was like, you know, let me cover up my hands, innit?
Because mm-hmm.
they can't see my hands. So then it's more like, because you know, like, who's that? Oh, some black guy. Yeah, put camera down, innit? So that's why I was like, let me cover my hands up. Bruh, there was bare pictures.
No way.
And then loads of kids are, hey, man, who are you, man? And I was just walking. I said, no, I'm getting these snaps, bro.
Did you take the mask off at all? No, or did you walk straight in?
After I got into the house, I took it off.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
I couldn't see where I was going, innit? And I was sweating and the mask was hot and I couldn't breathe properly. But I said, look, man, I came for the snaps.
You came for the pictures this time around. That situation will humble you so quickly.
I'll humble you, man. You
honestly.
Know who you are, boy.
How are you doing anyway, man?
I'm very good, man. It's good to be here, bro. It's very well to be here, man. You're smashing it yourself, bro.
Thank you very much, man. Looking to
hearing great things about you, bro. That's
all
very
right,
good, man.
Sick. Well, I appreciate that, man.
Yeah,
I don't
man.
Think anyone said that before.
Oh, that's good, bro.
That's, nice,
that's what
man.
I mean. Most of these people come on their stuff, they plug their stuff. Yeah, man, got the tour, got the music album coming out. All right, thanks, bye. Do you know what I mean? You got to give something back, man. You got to let man know. Look, you're doing well, man.
Thank you very much. You're not doing too bad.
The community's
well.
Got your back.
Yeah, you got my back.
Yeah. It's like I have no mad tweets on that minute. Yeah. I got to log out from that.
We're going to talk about tweets, actually, man. But talk to me. Yeah. That Couple of Cans tour seemed like it went on for ages. You were just killing it night after night. How many dates was it?
Yeah. So I don't know how many dates it was. Weirdly enough, I opened up a production company like last month and I put that poster up.
Mm-hmm.
And that was mostly the first time I've seen a poster in about a year. And I seen all the dates.
Man.
And then it came flooding back like, oh my God, I've done all these dates. But yeah, I just know we started in October the 1st, 2017, and it ended like this year in April, 2019. Yeah.
Goodness gracious.
So yeah. I don't know how many dates we've done. But weirdly enough, I guess like when we're doing a tour, you're just worried about doing a tour as opposed to like numbers and stats.
Stuff like that,
it's only until afterwards then I was like, oh my God, we sold like 50,000 tickets or we've done, you know, this many shows here and whatnot.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, when I'm in the mix of it though, I'm just like, wanted to perform.
Yeah,
know?
I guess that's the bread and butter, isn't it? That's what
you care about most.
That's it. What you got to do.
Of course,
right?
Man. Yeah, man.
That's mental. What was life saying for you before comedy?
South London? South London. Yeah.
It's
yeah.
in the water there, man. Yeah. What are they feeding you?
So that's what I mean. Everyone's in South, innit? That's just what it is. East London got the grime.
Yeah.
We just got everything else, boy. Nah, you know, so I grew up in Camberwell and then we moved to Peckham when I was like 15. And then for me, I was always doing stand-up. I've been stand-up for like a long time, just doing the circuit. And I was working in retail, was like part-time. That was like my little side hustle. So I always get quite annoyed when you ever see these, like, you know, when there's like a famous actor that's not working anymore and then you say, oh, this person's working in as a waitress. It's like, that's a hustle, man.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? We got to pay our bills, you know? So yeah, that was my last job. I was in Levi, just down the road in Covent Garden.
No way.
And yeah, I was just like doing the retail shift, basically. And then it started, like when I was posting the videos up, it started to go like quite well, getting some cool opportunities. And then that was mostly one of the harder decisions I've had to make of like,
coming
do I leave?
Of,
because
okay.
as soon as I left, I was like, I don't want to go back in it. That's the goal is to do something and not go back and say, I've left. So, and I remember how I left was not like some big like, guys, So you guys know things are going well.
The K video when he's coming down. Yes. Yeah.
Nah, I didn't get that. You didn't get that. I think my one was a text. They was like, "Can you do a Monday?" I was like, "Nah, I can't do the Monday." They was like, "Why not?" I was like, "Oh, because I think I tried to get a shift swap or something." And they was like, "Nah, we can't swap that shift." I was like, "Yeah, I think I'm just going to leave, you know, because I just don't really feel like, you know, I need to be here anymore." Not in a rude way. They kind of understood a little bit as well. And then, yeah, we just, that was it. That was just gone.
It was
good.
Comedy during and comedy ever since.
Yeah. So I've always done stand up. Even when I was working in retail, I always try and, you know, plan like my work around what I do. So for example, I wouldn't want to take like a night shift or overnights and stuff. So I'd say like, I've got this comedy show, or can I get this time off and stuff like that. So I'd always plan it around what I was doing. And I always say my job was always to fund my career. That was always the plan of just like, just do this 9 to 5. In retail, just to fund your career, whether I need to buy equipment or, you know, pay your bills when you thought you had a show and it gets cancelled. It's always there's like a backup. But at the same time, my mum was like, "Do what you want, but just pay the rent, innit?"
Okay.
So I just need to make sure rent was paid, innit?
Each
month. You know what I mean? So yeah, man.
What was the turning point for you then, in and around all of this time? What's the time frame, time period? How old?
Yeah.
Were you?
So
this all sort of happens.
Well, how old was I? I guess I was like 20. Nine, I think I want to say.
Yeah.
29. And that was like it's weird because you get to that stage of your life where you're like, okay, cool, like I'm about to hit 30. Like, I don't know, like, I don't really know what to do, kind of thing. Do I do this? Do I carry on working and stuff? You know, friends are like I'm looking to get a mortgage and people
marriage,
going on nice like holidays and stuff. Mm. And I'm sitting there in part-time retail. And as I said, like, I started to do the videos, and the videos was just fun, innit? I'd done them as fun. I'd edit them myself. And then what I'd do, I'd make like the videos before work and then upload them. And they started going well, you know, like one of them went viral, which was like the different types of MCs. So that's like, you know, the MC you get who misses the drop, like the MC up north and stuff. So that went viral on GRM Daily. And then I remember going into work like 2-3 days later. And I told people I'd done comedy, but like, I never really like, that. I didn't say like come to shows and stuff. Yeah. So when I'd done this, one of the one of the girls was like, "Oh my God, you got a video, haven't you?" I've seen it. And I'm like, yeah. It's like, "Oh my God, it's so funny." So I'm like, "Thanks, man. Cheers." And weirdly enough, I started getting this following on social media. So as I put one video up, it just inspired me to do another one and do another one. And then I started getting this kind of traction as such. So that was kind of like the turning point where I was like, you know, then I started to get small opportunities and I started to do like my own small comedy nights, and I'd make like more money from doing these small comedy nights than I would in retail. And I was hosting it myself. So I was like, "Wow, this is kind of like, it's a bit like a tour a little bit."
Yeah.
Because it's just, I'd put loads of other comics on, but I'd host it and people just coming out. And I was like, "Wow, this is kind of like, kind of cool." And then I think it was in July 2017. I'd say June. That's when I said to my manager, I was like, "Do you know what? I really want to do a tour. Like, I want to capitalize on what's happening
what's going on right now.
And just show people I'm a stand-up comic, because the Cup of Cans thing was going well. People like that. It's like a, you know, like an online character I was doing. So people was like, "Oh, yeah, Cup of Cans." Like, but then I was like, "Well, I'm a comic first, isn't it? Like, I'm not really like a..." Because then it's like, so what are you, like an influencer, or you're like a... Yeah,
you don't want to get mixed up.
Yeah, and
then
people don't even know I'm a comic as well. So they don't know I'm a stand-up comedian. So then I was like, I need to like let people know I'm a comedian. So that's when I said, "Yeah, I think I really want to do a tour." And then I think we planned it with like Live Nation in June 2017. That was a big deal, because I was like, "Rah, Live Nation want to be behind this. Big Live Nation." Because I was going to do it myself, innit?
Oh, for real?
Yeah. And just do some tickets on like, "Yo, come get some tickets, my friends." Tickets, innit? you know the drop-offs? "Yo, listen, I'm in Stratford, Westfield now, innit?"
This number for Midland.
That's how I was going to do it, innit? So the fact that Live Nation were involved, I was like, "Wow, this is like a big deal." So we dotted out some dates, and it went on sale in July 2017, and London sold out in like 2 minutes.
Man.
So already I was like, "Whoa, like that's a big deal." Like big London sold out. And then other places, we had Birmingham booked in. So that was Birmingham Academy, like 1,000 people. In my head, I was like, "I don't know if people are going to come to this one. I'm not trying to do like half open, empty something." And then that one sold out later on. And then they just all started randomly, simultaneously, like Manchester sold out, Oxford, Cambridge. And then so London
added more dates.
Yeah. And then we started adding more dates due to demand and stuff. And they started selling out in like 4 minutes. And I was like, well, this is a bit mad because I know comics who have done shows and tours. And mm-hmm. I'm not saying I've never seen it, but at the same time, I was like, well, we just sold out 300 seats in 2 minutes. And then we'd had another one. And this, it was weird because people started getting a bit annoyed. It's like, come on, man. Like, two bigger venues. Like,
oh, for this is real? A joke.
How can you have just one place? And I didn't know how to take this criticism because I was like, look, I'm trying my best, guys. Like, mm-hmm, I'm sorry, innit? Mm-hmm. And yeah, this whole like kind of situation at the time, I just didn't know how to deal with it because I didn't have anyone around me mm-hmm. to say, this is what you do, or don't worry.
And it's first time.
And you don't
well.
Know if it's going to sell as well. So every time you're being like, oh, we might add more dates, you're like, okay, I think we should stop now because like I'm not trying
it's
to
right,
perform.
Right. Yeah,
I don't want like all these sold out ones and then this one's empty and stuff. So, and then, yeah, they all started selling out. And yeah, that was most probably, I guess, like when we started going on the road and you start seeing these people who had been watching your videos and, you know, people start saying stuff like, oh, like, can I have an autograph?
Yeah.
Like, an autograph? Like, okay, I thought that was more 90s thing, yeah. But like, okay,
I'll yeah.
start practicing the autograph.
No, but
and stuff.
You know what? With your show, that's it. Because yeah. the variety of people, like I've been as well, mm. the variety of people in the audience,
yeah,
I couldn't write it on paper who's going to come before.
Oh,
but you'll see
man.
Everyone.
Yeah, there, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Which
yeah.
is so cool.
I think that was always like one of the, I guess it was the reason why I just loved performing because I didn't know who was going to come to this tour. It's mm-hmm. not like I've done the tour before and I know who was coming. There was a lot of people, you know, I've seen groups of guys, groups of girls, couples, and there was older people just there, like people's mums and dads. And I'm like, how do you not know about
yeah,
me?
That yeah, was this yeah, is yeah, yeah.
These are the people. I was like, these are the people coming to watch me. I didn't know, you don't know who your fan base is until you start seeing
mm-hmm.
And it was just, yeah, it was so surreal, bruv. Like just seeing all these people come out, different walks of life and, you know, from different backgrounds, like religions and stuff. And I was like, well, this is properly happening. You
yeah,
know what I
yeah,
mean?
Yeah.
Like, yeah, man. But it was so fun, man. Really enjoyed it, man. Really. It was a big learning curve as well.
For real. Over know? A long time. What a turning point that is, man.
Oh,
do you feel
man.
Like we live in an age where you got to be quite politically correct?
Yeah.
And you got to be careful with what you say and stuff.
Yeah, yeah, of course.
Do you feel you maneuver that well? Or do you ever feel like, I got some jokes that I really want to tell, but...
No, do you know what it is? I guess with my stand-up is it's very observational, very physical. So a lot of it comes from me mm-hmm. and how I observe the world. And I've never, like, even when I was young, I never really had any jokes that were, like, edgy. Like, I told a joke and it split the room.
Yeah.
I just never had that kind of material. So there's never been a need for me to be like, okay, now I'm going to start upping the levels. Let me start. Because I just kind of developed a style. And weirdly enough, I didn't know this was a style until I got critics that would say, like, oh, yeah, he's like, great physicality. So I'm like, man's a physical comedian. He's observational wit. Man's observationally witty. Like,
yeah,
I didn't know. I just went out there and just told jokes.
Did
but
you?
I guess, yeah, like, obviously, like, you know, it changes, isn't it? Like, culture changes throughout the decades and stuff. And, you know, you think of like this last decade we're about to leave, of how that's changed compared to the last decade
last
of like.
Before, yeah.
So it always changes. But I guess for me, I always try and make comedy that's quite timeless.
Yeah.
So, you know, especially like with the special and the tour, you can kind of watch it and it can be any time in a year and you'd be like, oh, yeah, like, that's funny.
Yeah.
And every comic has their thing, innit? Like some people are great at political stuff and you can still look back at that. But I guess for me as a stand-up, I've always tried to, my goal is always to make people laugh and then make something you could like watch that's quite, or listen to as a stand-up that's quite timely.
Mm-hmm.
So you could watch it anytime and you could always find it funny. As opposed to you like, oh guys, remember Blackberries? And everyone's like, yeah,
oh,
I do, but
that's,
do you know
yeah.
what I mean? Like, yeah, yeah.
No, that, so, makes yeah. sense. That makes sense as well. Have you ever told a joke
yeah.
that you thought should have got way more laughs than it did?
Oh yeah, of course, man. That's the part and parcel of like stand-up. You know, you tell material and I always find when I'm trying to write funny, so if I'm sitting there and I'm like, I'm gonna write something funny, it's never funny.
Oh, for real?
Never funny. As opposed to I've had some of my best jokes have come through just doing it improv on stage. And I'm like, bro, you look funny. Bro, hey, I just made this up now. And a lot of time, I laugh at my own jokes on stage, innit? That's just like what I like doing. So there's a lot of times you'll just see me just laughing
just
on stage.
Up.
And yeah, I just like to show the audience that I enjoy it as well, innit? Like, I know I'm here, like, you know, you got to be perfect. That's what they say, innit? It's a comic, you can't laugh at your own stuff, innit?
Yeah.
I don't want to be that cool, man. I want to feel like I'm in the moment with everyone else. Yeah. So even with the tour, I've told some jokes hundreds of times, but they still make me laugh when everyone else laughs at them.
That's a good sign.
So yeah, I just like proper enjoy what I do, I guess, innit? But at the same time, it's like, when I'm on stage, I want to enjoy it. I don't want to see it as like, oh, man, I've got to tell this joke again. Do you know what I mean? But there is a thing of when you are on tour, when you are telling the same material every night, you want to try something new. You may be like, let me try this one. Like, we've done that a lot on tour. And I was like, yeah, I'm going to try it. And then some of them didn't bang in it. So I was like, let's go back to that tour stuff.
When does television become a part of the journey then?
So television kind of came within like 2017. I'd had like, because I guess with like, with Channel 4 and like, I'd done, like, you know, when you're kind of starting out, you always have development meetings. That's just a given to go into Channel 4 or BBC 3 and all these kind of, you know, television stations and production companies and mix up ideas and whatnot. So like, the conversation was always there with Channel 4. It wasn't like they just like, hey, you're the next guy. You know what I mean? Like, so the conversation was always there. We had like another project I'd done previously with them, just like a kind of something I was developing. And then, yeah, like, you know, the Couple of Cans tour was like getting a lot of buzz, you know, around the TV world as such. Like, oh, you got to check out this guy. He's turning out these shows and stuff. And I remember doing this show, yeah. We had this show in Camden and I'd go out there first as the geezer character, yeah. Mm-hmm. So I always do this thing like, where are you from? Like, kind of, so I'm like, where are you from? This guy's like, oh, I'm from like Kensal Rise or whatever. So I'm like, oh, great. Where'd you work? He's like, I work at Channel 4. So I'm like, oh, okay. Let me not mess up any jobs. So then I was like, okay, cool. What's happening, mate? Where are you from, mate? He's like, oh, I'm from, I live in Shoreditch or whatnot. I was like, oh, great. Where'd you work, mate? Yeah, I work at Vice. I'm like, bro, what are the chances? What's going on right now?
Yeah.
I can't even banter with these guys. So like that started to be a turning point on shows where, you know, people from TV were coming to watch the show and stuff. The date was October. No, it wasn't October, sorry. It was December. And yeah, I, you know, me and my manager got invited to go into Channel 4 for a meeting. My manager probably didn't have an idea what the meeting was about. Because normally a manager sets you up, innit? This meeting's about
yeah,
this.
Yeah, yeah,
I'm going to talk about that.
You're going there with blah, not blah, a lot blah, of prep blah, blah, this blah. Time.
So I didn't know what it was about. And bearing in mind, I had developed meetings before. So it wasn't like I was going there like, okay, cool. Like, okay, I don't know what I'm going to get out of this meeting. So yeah, I went in there and a lady called Saida. She was like, hey, like, I went to your show. I loved it. I think it's great. And I'd like to offer you a show, 10 o'clock entertainment show on Channel 4.
Crazy.
For that, I remember I swore at the time, innit?
Yeah.
I was like, oh, like, and then I was just so shocked. That's the last thing I thought I said, hold on, what? On Channel 4 at 10 o'clock, you want me to host this? And I was like, yeah. Like, then they said, yeah, you can like pick a range of production companies you want to work with. I said, what? What was the catch? Yeah. And in the same meeting, they said, yeah, we're also doing this project with Big Nasty as well. And yeah, we'd love to get you involved in that as well. You know, we start, you know, doing the pilot in 2 months' time. So yeah, we got some meetings lined up. And I was like, hold on a sec, what's going on here?
Yeah. Like, so all in that one meeting?
In that one meeting.
Okay, so it weren't like you had Big Nasty, then it's like, okay, come back.
Nah, in the same meeting, innit? And it was weird because I knew who Big Nasty was, but we weren't, like, boys weren't friends.
Mm-hmm.
I just knew who he was from. He's, like, really funny videos and his Uncle Payne stuff. So it was weird because I didn't even really know him. And I remember I met him at this early. I had this, like, Call of Duty event, which is, like, I had to, like, it was him, me and some other people, some rappers. I think it's like, AJ Tracy was there or someone like that. And I had to make, while we're playing the game, I think I had to make Big Nasty laugh or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
This is the first time we're meeting. So imagine I've met him. So I was like, what's going on, Nasty, all right? He's like, yo, what's going on, bruv? You cool, bruv? And one other guy so goes to, oh, I heard you got like a TV thing going on. Yeah, Nasty. He goes, yeah, obviously, bruv. Get me like BBC 3 and Channel 4 fighting over me still. And I'm like, that's not true. Kind of doing something. And then he's like, he goes to the guy, yeah, obviously that man might get you a little part in the thing still. So I'm sitting there like, does this guy know that we're doing something together, innit? Like, we had a meeting like the next week, innit?
Yeah.
So I was like, yeah, well, you know, we got a meeting next week. And he's like, oh, okay, yeah, sick, man, sick, brother, sick. And I'm like, I don't think he's this guy has a clue what's going on. And then we seen each other the next week. And then it was so funny because we sat down, he comes in with his people and stuff. And then we sat down and then we were just going through like brainstorming ideas for the pilot and what we want to do and stuff like that. And then I'm an ideas person, innit? Mm, I've got bare ideas for this stuff, innit? So I was just like, okay, cool. What? Because someone said, oh, what about this? So immediately I was like, now I think, what we should do? Do this, because that would make sense. I get to see babies, people like, hey, who's this guy, bro?
Yeah.
Who's this mo guy, bro? All these ideas. But yeah, nah, man. And then, yeah, through that, that's how I kind of got into the TV world, really. Just kind of learning the craft as well, just like as I'm on set, just seeing how things are done and stuff. And yeah, that's kind of where the journey of TV starts, if I'm honest. Yeah,
okay,
man.
Okay, and continues. What's so cool to see, I've grown up watching shows like Jonathan Ross.
Yeah, of course.
So like seeing you have a show, which is, I think, when, say, we were younger, it's like everyone wanted to see that.
Yeah.
And it's taken time and we see it now.
Yeah.
But then seeing you on the shows like Jonathan Ross, where you're mixing up with all of these different people, who's like the most famous person you've met? And how do you feel in those situations? Because obviously it's happened quite quick.
Yeah, no, of course. I think the most famous person that I've met, because there's sometimes I've been in someone's presence.
Yeah.
I didn't really feel like I met them though. It's very brief. Hello, you're right, nice to meet you. Cool. And it's done.
That's a like, different sort.
That person just doesn't even know I exist anymore once they walk away in it. But like, I remember meeting Seal, yeah?
Okay.
And everyone's always surprised about this. But the way it happened, yeah? Because I've listened to Seal, you know what I mean? Ordinary people, dum, dum, dum. He's got some tunes, man.
Yeah.
So then, basically, like, it's my birthday. Me and him share the same birthday. So my manager, a few days before, says, Seal's invited you to, he's performing at London Palladium. So I was like, oh, that's a bit random. Oh, okay, cool. Like, I'll go to that. So it's my birthday. Seal messages me, hey, bro, happy birthday. Get a couple of cans in, mate, or something like that.
No way.
So I'm like, rah, that's mad. Like, okay, cool. And he's like, yeah, happy birthday. We share the same birthday, me and Seal. So I was like, oh, cool. Yeah, like, happy birthday. He's weird. Like, yeah, happy birthday to you too, bro. Like, I don't know what to say.
Yeah.
So then, I remember he invited me to his night he was performing at. And when he's performing on stage, like, he's doing like some, like, he's redoing some old songs, but he's like Frank Sinatra and stuff before he gets into his set. It's packed. He puts me in like a box. Me and my mum go in it with a box and that. And he's doing one of his songs, yeah? And then out of nowhere, he's in his songs and he goes, yeah, get a couple of cans. And I'm like, bro, like, me and my mum look at each other like, bro, like, do you hear that, bro? Like, me and my mum are fully like, yo, like, the man just say a couple of cans, like.
Yeah.
So then we kind of look at each other like, right, because the whole crowd are quite oblivious. But
yeah.
I know what I heard, innit?
You know, yeah. Okay.
So already I'm like, that was a bit mad, innit? And then he's performing and he's doing the hits now, innit? Everyone's vibing. It was a wicked concert. And his manager comes upstairs and she goes, hi, Seal would personally like to see you.
No
so
way.
I said, okay, all right, cool. Want to see me? Yeah, all right, cool. So we go downstairs and there's like some real like VIP fans in it. They played for like some platinum pass. They got their books ready to get signed in it. And they're like waiting at the side in his green room. Some, you know, his friends are there and family and whatnot and stuff. And me and my mum were just kind of like waiting at the back in the corner in it. We're just like, what do I do? Like, go up to him. Yo, Seal, so you want to see me? Like, yeah. I didn't know what to do.
Yeah.
So we're kind of sitting in the back. And then out of nowhere, all I heard is, yo, couple of cans, wheel it up, man. And I was like, and then he just comes over to me, innit? Like, just greets me, this big hug.
Yeah.
It was mad awkward because as he's walking to me, there's this one fan in it who thinks he's talking to him. So this guy's like, hey, man. And he's just like, and I was like, yo, what's going on? And then, like, we started talking. And the funniest moment was, like, he started talking. He's like, yeah, I love the videos, man. The geezer, a couple of cans. I'm talking to his brother and stuff. And because he lives in the States, innit? So he was like, yeah, like, I grew up watching that stuff, innit? My mum's fully smiling, grinning teeth, like, yeah, man. Yeah, I know what you mean. I'm looking at my mum like, you didn't have this energy when when I said, do you want the tickets? Like, so then And then he just starts singing, innit? He just goes, what? Wheel up the blood clot, wheel it up now. So, bruv, me being me in this social media generation, I was like, I gotta get this on the Snapchat, innit?
Yeah.
I don't know about you lot, but Seal ain't singing to no one else's phone, innit? So I was like, yeah, that's good. Do that in my phone, though, yeah. Just keep doing that on Snapchat, keep going. So, yeah, man, lovely guy, man. And he was like, just that, you know, like someone who's like, just huge as a like, just huge. You say the name around the world and people know who that is. And then, yeah, just the fact that he was just like, yo, man, like come to the show and just seem like a really nice, genuine bloke, man. You know what
it's
I mean?
Crazy.
I met Drake at the Wireless, which was last year. That was kind of cool because that was just like, I think I walked through that backstage. But you know, it's like backstage.
Yeah.
It's like backstage, but it's also like, there's like, you know, they got Nando's there. Everyone's there chilling out. It's all cool and stuff. So it's like, no, when people see Noah, everyone's like, yeah, cool.
Yeah, like, everyone's like, we're all cool.
And
so
then,
we can all
you know,
like
people always walk around security and stuff. So you can't really approach
get to know
them. So everyone's all cool. So I remember going through to the backstage, man. I wanted to go through. The security said I couldn't, and ended up letting me go through. So I walked out. And there's like, I don't know if you know, like basically the backstage, but you know, it kind of goes up as like a hill. The top of the hill is where they got the kind of, what they call the trailer
thing. Behind the
things. Stage bit. Yeah, like where they got like the kind of trailers and stuff.
Yeah.
That section's locked off, innit? So Drake, I see Drake, so I'm like, oh, right, there's Drake over there kind of thing, innit?
First time meeting.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And he looks at me and is like, yo, what's going on? So I'm like, are you talking to me? Is there someone else around here?
Yeah.
And I was with Javan, funny enough. Me, Javan, and my other friend Chris. And he comes over and then he's like, yo, what's going on, bro? You cool? Like, yeah, man, how's things? But I was like, yeah, good, man. I was like, you performing tonight? He's like, yeah, performing, man. And he's like, so what are you saying, man? You going out tonight? And I was just like, yeah, I don't know, I might see. And I got a friend of mine called Chris. He's like French, but he's got this weird American accent, innit?
All right.
So I was like, it's being cool. And so Jake goes, yeah, man, so we're going out tonight, man. You come in and stuff? So I was like, yeah, I don't know, man. I might see, man. Here, my friend Chris. I don't know, man. We might go out tonight, maybe. Like, bruv, you're killing the cool, innit? Like, just, you know, you're like, this is my friend, innit?
Yeah, yeah.
But most probably, it's just, you know what it is? Like, The stardom of those two people and just how cool they was always like reminds you of just like, it doesn't sometimes matter how big you are, like when you can just make time for people,
for someone,
that's it. Do you know what I mean? That's kind of what it is essentially. And people will always remember those things.
Facts.
You know what I mean?
Like the way you bigged me up at the beginning of the interview.
Yeah, of course, man. Of course, man. You know what I mean? So yeah, like I think they were all, like, there's tons of other people I could most probably list off and stuff, and people we've had on like the latest show. Like Mel B was really cool and stuff. So there's like tons of people. But yeah, I guess it's like when you get into this kind of world of like entertainment and stuff, you kind of want to meet people for like who they are a little bit as well, as opposed to, oh my God, you're the big pop star.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? So, yeah, man.
Cool. Before you go, I know you got to go real quick. We've got to talk about the tour, but I wanted to ask you, over, let's say, the tour period, music-wise, from the UK, what three tracks could sum up this period of life?
Tricky
one.
That is a hard one, man.
Something you woke up to in the morning, something you played before you went on, but it has to be from the UK. What one could you tie?
Oh, my gosh, that's so hard. Because you know what? I'm thinking of tracks. I'm thinking of artists at the moment. So already I'm thinking of like Jay Huss. I don't know what Jay Huss track though. But I'm thinking of something Huss. I don't know why. I'm thinking Skepta. And maybe Stormzy, you know.
And Stormzy as well, yeah. Yeah.
Weirdly enough, do you know what's weird about it as well? Because like, I guess like, those three artists I listen to anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I'm not on listening to artists and stuff. But when I think of like those three artists, just in terms of my career, I don't know. Right, that one set me
it's
back,
crazy,
you know?
Yeah. It's tricky.
Got bare quiet.
Yeah.
But in terms of three tracks, I couldn't think of a track.
Artist is good enough. And I guess they've all had.
Maybe Stormzy, Where Do You Know Me From? Because the same with me, innit? Where do you know me from? Instagram? Channel 4? Netflix? Where do you know me from, innit? Yeah, man. That's if there was one track, I'd mostly use that track.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Makes sense, man. Tour, you're going around the world.
Yes.
What countries are we hitting up?
We're going Finland, Denmark. We're going to the States, and we're doing a lot in the States. We're going places like Chicago, Texas, Dallas, Houston. Houston, Dallas. We're going Toronto, Canada. We're going Australia, Paris, France.
Mm-hmm.
And weirdly enough, as I announced it, all these places, you had people like, come South Africa, come do a show in Ghana, come do a show in Singapore. And yeah, it just opens up my mind of like, well, maybe we might take it there. That's the plan. Never say never, really. So yeah, man, we're doing a bunch of places, some great venues as well, you know, in these places as well. So yeah, I'm just excited to this. Some of these places I've never been to, so it'll be eye-opening for me as well, and just the team as well, just to go to these places and just kind of take my brand of comedy to the world, which is something I've always wanted to do. So it kind of is a dream just to do this world tour at the same time. Like, I am pinching myself, like, wow, I'm going to the States, or I'm going to Finland.
Mm-hmm.
Finland, you know, me in Finland. Can you imagine?
Drugs.
No one could imagine this.
They weren't imagining it when they were booking you to do shit.
I said Helsinki, yeah? Let's go there, innit?
Cool, say no more. When you come back, please, we've got to chop it up again.
Yeah, no, we're exactly doing like a catch-up still.
I'll
be mad tired. I remember you first started your tour, you was all bubbly, man.
Yeah,
put on weight.
Glasses, coffee, that's it.
Yeah. Yeah, let's wrap this up, man.
Wicked.